which is in terabytes of the data, or the data which is in petabytes of the data, or the data which is in exabytes of the data, right? So this is what we call the big data, right? Then what kind of the data, the data can be a structured data, or a data can be unstructured data, or a data can be semi-structured data, right? So what is the structured data? Suppose you have an RDBMS, right? So we have the tables where the data is defined in the form of rows and columns. Then we can able to right, so we can able to differentiate primary key and the foreign key, so that right, we can able to establish the constraints. So that's a structured data. Then what is an unstructured data? So unstructured data, the best example is like flat files, right? If you write something in a notepad, so is the best example for the unstructured data. Then what is the semi-structured data? Semi-structured data means the structure is defined, but it's not mandatory to follow the structure. You take an example, an XML document is an example for a semi-structured data, or a JSON data is an example for semi-structured data. That means now the Hadoop, sorry, the big data is going to work with the bulk amount of data, and the data can be any format. So either you give the data from the production database, or you give the data from the servers. The data can be a CSV file, TSV file, or any XML format, or any JSON data, or any Avro schema, any Parquet data, whatever the data format it is, right? So the big data is going to work with that kind of data. So it is a bulk amount of data, and the data can be in the size of the bulk. That's either it can be a terabytes, petabytes, and exabytes of the data. And that data can be a structured, unstructured, semi-structured data, right? So this is what we call the big data. Then what we are going to do with the big data, right? So what we are going to do with big data, we are going to apply the big data analytics, okay? So why we are discussing about the big data? Because we have to run the big data analytics. Then what are the big data analytics? So big data analytics is something like, see, being an individual, right? So we are trying to buy a mobile. So then what we'll do, we'll ask, we'll go through the reviews. Then we'll ask our friends and colleagues who is already using the mobile, we'll collect the review, right? Being an individual, how much analysis we are running before making any purchase or before taking a decision? Then what about a business? What about a client which is having the multiple customers? Then how much did the decision they have to make, right? So what they are going to do now, they are going to apply the big data analytics. So big data analytics is a process of applying advanced analytics. What we are doing now? So we are applying advanced analytics and visualization techniques. So what are the meaning of visualization techniques? Now I want to present the data. So how we present the data? So I just want to represent the data in a graphical representation, right? So that's, we call it as a visualizations. So I'm going to apply the advanced analytical techniques and the applying the visualization techniques to the large data sets, so that we are going to identify the hidden patterns in the data. We are going to identify the unknown correlations in the data, so that a client or a business can able to take a better business decisions. A client or a business can able to predict and identify the changes. A business or a client can able to identify the new opportunities. So there are the so many things are the advantages when a client implemented big data analytics for their project. So now see here, applying the analytics on the big data, the data, whatever a client, a business previously considered as a spam, a junk data, right? The data which we cannot able to use and process, now the data we are taking, because you can give any format of the data, you can give any structure of the data, but we are taking and we are trying to process the data such a way that a client or a business may involve huge benefits once they apply the analytics and the data. a simple example here. I'll take the three examples on this big data analytics, why we need to run. The first thing is, I'll take a telecom domain, right? So in a telecom domain, so see, you can see in India, so we have MNPs there. That is, you can shift to some other network, right? If you're not satisfied. Suppose there are the two users are there. One user is an X and other user is a Y, right? So here, X is a user who messages every day and Y is a user who travels every day, right? So now, for this particular telecom client, so they are going to create a new plan. So they have their own data science team is there. So who works on the functional part? So they have created a new plan. Consider the new plan related to messaging, right? So they have introduced a new plan, the new plan related to messaging. Then they have suggested this message plan to their customers. What they did, they suggested this messaging plan to user Y, right? Actually, user Y is a traveler who travels frequently, who is looking for a little bit roaming kind of plan, right? So where he will get a little bit of flexibility in the price. But what you did, you suggested the messaging plan to the Y. So here, Y is not going to use this plan. So Y is not going to get the benefit, as well as the client business won't get the benefit. This is simple logic that we already know that. So where the big data analytics comes. Now, see here, how we should able to identify the users and their requirements. A telecom domain may have many number of users, right? So they have the users, like millions of users are there. Now, identifying, understanding the requirements of each and every user, right? So what I'm going to do, I'm going to collect the data. So whatever the number of recharges you are making, number of voice calls, number of STD calls, how much GPRS you are using, did you need a 3G, did you need a 4G? So I'm trying to collect all your usage. Based on that, I'm going to run some queries. I'm going to run some analytics and this data so that I can able to identify the individual requirements of each and every user. So that is a client, how they are getting the benefit when they apply the big data analytics. Simply what they will do now, so they'll collect all your data. So whenever a user tries, whenever user makes a voice call, whenever user makes an STD call, when you started messaging, so they'll try to record all the activities, your usage. Now they'll give it to Hadoop developer, we'll take the data, we'll process such that the data such a way that so that we can able to identify, we can able to understand the requirements of each and every user. Otherwise, we'll take another example. So, right, we already knows that the iPhone, Apple mobiles, right? So you're working with some application, you're playing a game. Now your mobile got struck up, right? So you had some issues, your mobile is restarted. So it will send, you want to send this error message to the manufacturer. Right now, how many users around the world is having an issues, right? So there are issues that, general issues everybody is facing. So there are some time, the first issue, right? The first time a client, a user is getting that one. So now everybody is sending this messages to the manufacturer. So here, these messages, the data is sent by the machines. Right, so your machine, that's the mobile phone, will send a message to the manufacturer. Right, you're working with a Windows laptop, right? So you got stuck up, so you want to send a crash report, or you're using a Windows mobile, you want to send the feedback. So they'll collect all the data. So the data which is generated by the machines, which we call it as a machine data. Now, so what they have to do, they have to identify all the messages, they have to identify the bugs, they have to identify the new bugs, and they can able to do the bug fix. When they are coming up with the next update, when they are coming with the next release, they can able to provide the solution for the new bug fixes, provide the solution for the new bugs, new issues, right? So this is the machines sending the data to the manufacturer. So manufacturer is going to run the machine data analytics on the machine data, right? So this is one example. And it's a very simple and another example, I'm taking here e-commerce client. Okay, so here I'm taking Amazon.com, right? So we are very much buys the products frequently in Amazon. So see, if a client is implementing big data analytics, yeah, they have their regular data processing is available, right? So they don't think that they are completely migrating, right? So they have their regular architecture is there. So now they want to run analytics on their customers' data. So generally identify the behavior of the customer, recommendations based upon the products, right? So they use big data. Suppose here, whenever a user visits a product, so they are going to write that information into a file. The file name is prod_info.txt. Alright, okay. So what is the file name? prod_info.txt. So what this file contains, whenever a user visits a product, his name and the product which he visited and the time when he visited. So they are going to write this into a file. So consider Ajay is a user who visited iPhone 6. When he visited on sometime today, right? The similarly, Hari visited some HTC mobile and sometime he visited the product, right? Similarly, Sandeep, he visited some Nokia, right? And sometime he visited the product, right? So Harsha visited some mobile and sometime. Right? Is there any limit that only one user has to visit the product specific number of times? A user can visit the product any number of times, right? So whenever a user visits a product, his name is going to be written into this file. Consider Ajay is a user, again he visited iPhone 6. Okay? Right? So in a some other time. So in a day, so Ajay visited total 100 times. How many times Ajay visited iPhone 6? 100 times he visited the iPhone 6. That is 100 times his name is written into this file. And this is a OLAP, right? What is the difference between OLAP and OLTP? OLAP means end of the day. OLTP is simultaneous transaction processing. So now this OLAP, that is end of the day, means today's transactions are going to be evaluated at the end of the day. Right, so at the middle mid of the day I cannot give you today's data, right? So the today's data is going to be analyzed end of the day, right? It's a OLAP. Now at the end of the day, right, the client wants to know like how many users visited iPhone 6 today. Then so they have sent a mail, the right, the seller sent a mail to the manager to know that how many mobile phones, right, how many users visited the product. So they call the developer, yeah, Mr. my dear Hadoop developer, you take this file, prod_info.txt, take this file and find out how many, right, how many users visited iPhone 6 today, right? So he raised a question. Now you take the data, then find out how many users visited iPhone 6 today. Now, so you have to take the data where product name equal to iPhone 6, count to the username, right? So this is a query we have to write. Then when you're starting the count, then iPhone 6 is visited by the Ajay 100 times. So for each record when you're counting, so can you count Ajay as 100 users? Because of his name exists 100 times in the data set, can you count Ajay as 100 users? No, right? No. Even though Ajay name exists 100 times in the data set, you have to consider him as only one user, correct? Right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Then he raised one more question. Your manager called and asked the question, how many times each user visited the product, right? So he wants to know how many times each user visited the product. Now in the second run, now for each user, now you have to count how many number of times he visits the product. Now in this scenario, Ajay is a user, all right? How many times he visited the iPhone 6? Right, 100 times. So now for this query, you have to consider Ajay as a 100 users, right? In the first query, I'm taking Ajay as a one user. In the second query, I'm running Ajay as a 100 users. So this is what we call it as a analytics. The querying the data, this way we call it as a big data analytics. Then you can say, yeah Ajay, this is, we have a distinct keyword here, right? But the distinct keyword works with the when the data is going to be structured. Here your data is available in a plain text file, the data which is written in a notepad. We are taking the data from the notepad and we are going to write the queries such a way that we are going to retrieve the data, right? So this is what we call the querying the data. This way is known as a big data analytics. So what is the benefit here? The benefit here is predictive analysis. What is a predictive analysis? Now the seller wants to know what will the sales next month, right? So you take the data from the last couple of days, now find out, so how many products are going to sell in the next week? So what will be the sales for the next month, right? So you have to take the data. Now you have to identify, suppose a user visited a product into the cart but not finalized the purchase. User make the payment but the purchase transaction got failed. A user visited a product multiple number of times but didn't finalize the purchase. Right, so these are the different users. Maybe they are going to buy the product. A user coming and every day he is visiting a product but he's not making the purchase. Maybe he's looking for the price difference but he's going to buy, right? So like this, you have to take the data. So we are going to analyze, so what will be the sales next month, right? So we are going to identify the predictive analysis. We are going to run the behavioral analysis that they can identify the customer behavior. Right, they are going to identify the behavior analysis. So these are the advantages with the big data analytics, right? So now you know what is a big data and what we are going to do with the big data analytics. So that when you trying to query the data this way, so the advantages are a client or a business can able to identify the new changes, they can able to take a perfect decision, right? So these are the benefits. Then the question is, so how to implement this big data analytics? Where to write this big data analytics, right? How to write these queries, right? So the big data analytics can be implemented the best with frameworks or the programmings. One is you can use SAP HANA is available in the market, right, where we can run the big data analytics, or you can use Oracle Exadata is available to run the big data analytics, or you can use Teradata, or you can, I'm taking here Apache Hadoop, right? So these are the different programming tools which are available in the market to work with the big data analytics. Then why there is a huge implementation of the Hadoop in the market, you know, right? So in the coming days, this is when I used to tell in the last year, so in every year, in the coming year, every client will have the Hadoop in the market. The same thing right now we are going to see that every business, every client have the Hadoop in their business, right? So in the coming days, so the Hadoop will be implemented such a way that there is no client will have you find without big data analytics, without Hadoop, right? So Hadoop is going to be that much of famous in the coming days, right? Even a small business to a big business, they are going to implement the Hadoop. I'm going to give you the reason why the Hadoop is the best in the market and why you have we are getting those many number of implementations, right? So the first thing is, if you want to go with SAP HANA, right, you need to buy the hardware to store the data. Then to implement big data analytics on the SAP HANA, you have to buy the application engine. It's a programming part, that's we call it as application engine. HANA is having HANA appliances, okay? So then you have to buy the license, then you have to pay the support, okay? You have to pay the support, right, if you implement the SAP HANA. Now it is the same thing for Oracle Exadata and it is same thing for the Teradata, okay? So then coming to the Hadoop, Hadoop supports commodity hardware, okay? Hadoop supports commodity hardware. So what is a commodity hardware? Commodity hardware means they are the low priced, low end, that is you can say inexpensive storage machines, right? So we always, Hadoop suggests you to go and buy the low priced inexpensive storage machines store the data, right? We can easily differentiate between the iPhone and the Micro Max, right? So iPhone 6 will give you the long run, right? Micro Max, maybe we don't know when it is going to be failure, right? But we are suggesting you to go and buy the inexpensive low price storage machines. Then you say it goes down. Yeah, let it goes down. It doesn't make any sense in the data processing. It doesn't make any issue in your, to the your data processing, right? So we always suggest you to go and buy the inexpensive storage machine. To be clearly say that the commodity hardware, a client is having the two options here. if you want to go with infrastructure to configure the Hadoop cluster, or you don't want to go with the infrastructure, right? So one is going with infrastructure or no infrastructure. See, suppose whenever you want to implement something, right, for in your project, for a client, right, for a client, there are the two important things are, suppose you are a project manager and now you are talking to your client to implement new things for the project. A client always talks about the cost, right? The top priority for a client is a cost. Then second one is high availability. The one which you're making, right, which you're configuring will be should up and run 24/7, 365 days, right? You should give the maximum high availability. So always remember, for a client, for a business, the two important things are cost, implementation cost, and its availability, high availability. So this is always client looks for these two things. Now, when you're trying to implement Hadoop for the project, so now you have an option to choose with infrastructure or no infrastructure, right? Suppose if you are going with infrastructure, suppose clients wants to integrate its own Hadoop cluster, right? If you want to go with infrastructure, right? So he can go and buy the inexpensive storage machines, right? So don't invest much on the infrastructure. You go and buy inexpensive, low price storage machines to store the data, right? Otherwise, right, you can use existing infrastructure. If you are buying a new one, so buy the low priced storage machines, store the data. Or you can use existing infrastructure, right? Hadoop can be integrated into any framework. That is, we can use Hadoop in SAP HANA. We can use Hadoop in Oracle Exadata. We can use Hadoop in a Teradata. We can run Hadoop as a service. When you run something as a service, we can able to integrate into anywhere. So we can able to configure Hadoop in a existing infrastructure. So if you configure Hadoop in your existing infrastructure, your cost is almost zero, right? So that is the one reason why a client will try to implement Hadoop. So the implementation cost and the storage hardware cost is, if you are going with existing infrastructure, it is almost zero. Or you go and buy the inexpensive storage machines to store the data. Suppose you don't want the infrastructure. If you don't want the infrastructure, then use Hadoop in a cloud, right? Use Hadoop in cloud. So we have Amazon Web Services available. That's, you have Amazon S3 server is available, right? So Amazon EC2 cluster, right? So you have to use the service providers, rent the storage, dump all your data, and start processing the jobs, right? So we can run Hadoop into the cloud. So when it is this about hardware to configure the Hadoop cluster. So if you're going with the existing infrastructure, so your implementation cost is zero, right? Then second thing is application engine, the programming part, right? How to code, where to code, which programming language we need to know to work with Hadoop, right? The application engine. Okay, so application engine means the programming part. The programming part, right? So now you can use a C language. It's a free and open source. C++. It's a free and open source. Java, it's a free and open source, right? Suppose you are new to the programming, you are very new to the programming and you don't know C++, Java, then you can learn, start writing the jobs in a Hive or the PIG programming, right? Which we can use in a application engine to process the data, right? Who will provide the license initially? The license provider is Apache. How much? It is free. And moreover, it is a open source programming. It is a open source code, right? So the license provider is Apache and the price is free and it is open source. Okay, then I'm having a dedicated Hadoop cluster is there. So we are having many issues arises, so we are looking somebody to support, right? Generally, if you need a support, right, so the Apache won't provide the support. Okay, so Apache won't provide the support, but you're looking for somebody to support your issue, right? In that case, if you are looking for a dedicated support, then you have to buy the Hadoop. So as of now, Apache won't provide the support. Then if you implement Apache Hadoop, if you want to get the support, how to get the support, you have to, many forums are available. So we have available in a community, Jira is available. So you have to write all your issues, then you can get your issue resolved with the experts. So that's only available, right? So you have to get issue resolved with the public forums. Now, suppose you are looking at dedicated support, right? So you need to configure a multi-node cluster, 100-node cluster is there. So there are many issues arises. Our team may not be able to resolve, right? We are looking for level 1, level 2, level 3 kind of support, right? So you need a support. In that case, you have to buy the Hadoop. Okay, so in this case, you have to buy the Hadoop. So if you use Hadoop from the Apache, it is free and open source, right? So if you are looking for a dedicated support, then you have to buy the Hadoop. So from where you have to buy the Hadoop? So we call them as a Hadoop vendors or Hadoop distributors, right? So call them as a Hadoop vendors or the Hadoop distributors. So who are they? Right, so right now the Cloudera is first in the market, captured more number of clients. They are giving Hadoop in the form of CDH, right? The latest version is 5.5, so it to release 5.7 this week, right? So CDH 5.5, so in this one they are using Hadoop, the recent version is 2.7, and other Hadoop distributor is Hortonworks. So you have to buy the Hadoop from these people, Hortonworks. They are giving Hadoop in the form of SDP, the recent version which released last one, that is 2.4. So in this one they are using Hadoop 2.7. There is another distributor vendor is MapR, right? So they are giving Hadoop in a different versions, M3, M5, M7 versions are there, and with the Hadoop 2.7, right? So these are the main businesses who involve only in the Hadoop market. Apart from that, so we have Hadoop is available from the Intel, Microsoft, right, Dell, IBM, right? So they are the other vendors, but so these three, Cloudera, Hortonworks, MapR, mainly into the Hadoop business. Okay, even the Teradata is having their own Hadoop. Okay, so you have the Hadoop. Now your question is, do we need to learn individually Cloudera, Hortonworks, MapR? It's a different. See here, either it's a Cloudera or it's Hortonworks or it's a MapR. We are using Hadoop 2.7. That is, the movie is the same, but the theaters which we are playing is the different. Okay, the movie is the same, but the theaters where we are playing, it is a different. Then where the difference comes? The difference comes in the pricing. The difference comes in the features. The difference comes in the environment. Apart from that, the coding which we are using, right? What is an application engine we are using? It is the same thing in a Hadoop from the Cloudera. It's the same in Hortonworks. It's same in a MapR. So the way how we query, the way how we get the data, the way how we process, it's the same thing in all the Hadoop distributions. Only the difference comes in the pricing. The difference comes in the components which they are providing. That is, the difference comes in the features, right? But the actually, the Hadoop is same in all the Hadoop distributions. And this has a YARN, running on a YARN as an execution engine. YARN stands for yet another resource negotiator, right? So SDFS plus YARN. Right now we can use Spark 2 as an execution engine. That is, make the data available in SDFS and execute the job in a Spark environment. Get the data into SDFS, run the job on a YARN environment, or store the data or get the data to the SDFS and run the job in a MapReduce environment. So these are the execution engines. Even in the Hortonworks, we have SDFS plus Tej, right? It's one execution engine. So where we are going to run our jobs on this execution engines. So now the data storage is taking place in the SDFS, and the data processing can be done with the different execution engines which are available, right? Either you can use a MapReduce, or you can use a YARN, you can use a Spark, or you can use a Tej as an execution engine to execute the jobs where the data available in a SDFS. So what is the definition of the Hadoop? Hadoop is a distributed data processing system which supports a concept called JPOD. So we are going to have a bunch of disks, and the data is going to be distributed to this bunch of disks. Once the data is going to be distributed as a bunch of disks, then we are going to process the data. Processing data means executing the data or querying the data. So how we are going to process the data? We are going to process the data with a different execution environments. So you can run the job, or you can process the data with a MapReduce, or you can process the data with a Yarn environment, or you can use a Spark or a Tej as a execution engine to process the data. Right? Suppose
it's kind of similar to SQL, right?
Yeah, it's similar to SQL, MySQL programming.
Mm-hmm. And what, I mean, what is the difference between these two, SQL and Hive?
Hive is only client, MySQL is a database. And there is no comparison, the comparison cannot place because both are into different. Only the syntax, the way how you write is, it follows the MySQL kind of programming, that's it.
Okay.
Suppose we have...
Actually, we are using create table prod info, right? So where is the prod info table created?
It's created in SDFS.
Mm-hmm.
Right, okay. Because the file system is SDFS. It created SDFS. So Hive will have a specific storage directories there, warehouse, Hive warehouse. So this table will be stored into Hive warehouse. Right, this is... Okay. Right now, I'm going to teach showing like how the programming looks like in Hadoop. Okay, so we have a dedicated, right? So when we are discussing about the Hive, so I'm going to teach you about all the row format, what is the terminated, what are the delimiters, what is this load data, right? So we are going to teach, going to teach you on that session, right? So my intention is to show you how programming looks like in Hadoop.
Yeah, I got you.
Okay, suppose pick. Right, PIC is a one programming language. Why it is named as a PIC? Can anyone guess why specialty in a PIC?
No, we have no
the
idea.
The animal PIC.
Oh, animal PIC?
Yes. What is the special thing in animal PIC? Right. So PIC lives anywhere. PIC eats anything. It's a strong. Right. So that's special. Right. Our coding also, we can run this PIC program in a Hadoop cluster or a not Hadoop cluster. You can write it as a PIC program, or you can write it as a shell program, or you can run it as a Java program. So that is the specialty in a PIC. PIC is one of the Lord incarnation, right? Varaha Avataram. See how much strong it is. Yeah. So that's what it named as a PIC programming, right? So the same, it's very easy. The people who are basically from the functional programming, so it doesn't have a technical skills, right? So the people from the functional skills, they need to write some programming. So the PIC is very easy to learn, right? Writing a PIC program is like writing a paragraph in English. Like suppose if you write, so if generally how we write, if adult, right? If age greater than 18, right? He is going to be an adult, right? So then it's adult. So the same program in PIC, how we write? Filter users by age greater than 18, where adults equal to. So this is how PIC programming looks like. It's very easy programming, right? So the same above program, suppose what is the table name here? Prod info, right? So here it's a variable, prod info, relation name is a prod info. I have to load the data from where, from this file, right? So write this path, right? From this path, right? So what is the delimiter? Comma, right? So using, so that we write here as a PIC storage, that is comma, which separates each word in the file. So as schema, so what is, we have username is an string that we write here, char array, then prod name is a char array. Okay, and the time I'm taking here, this string, so that's I'm taking here, it is a char array. That's it. Now the data from this file is loaded into a relation prod info. To see the data, we write dump prod info, which is like select star from, right? So this is how a PIC program looks like, right? So a two lines in a PIC becomes 5 to 6 lines in a Hive, which becomes 200 lines in Java. So which one?
Yeah.
So it's based upon your requirement. So we can code either Hive or we can code this in a big, or we can code this in a Java, right? But most of the times we use right now, so most of the clients, big will be used to pre-processing the data and Hive is used to process the data.
Okay,
so this is how Epic programming looks like and Hive program looks like, right? So this is the most of the sessions in Hive, right? When we are discussing about the Hive, so I'll teach you about the Hive. It's a pig, we'll discuss the pig, right? All my sessions are, it's a completely practical oriented session. It's not like taking a PPT and explaining directly from the PPT, right? My sessions are completely practical oriented